Being recorded, and we are sharing now my screen.
Yep.
Good. Good morning. Welcome, everybody, to this new webinar of the series of webinars on citizen science of ECIU and the Smarter Project. Today we have the pleasure to have the first year's webinar with two very interesting presentations within the community of ECIU. And the title that we wanted to give to this webinar would be Simulation Games and the Student Social Engagement with Citizen Science. So I think that it's going to be really, really interesting. And we have a collection of experts that are going to present today. Ralph Otterpol, Vice Dean of International Faculty of Civil Environmental Engineering from Hamburg University of Technology. We have also Nancy Rivas, Project Coordinator, Development and Social Impact of the Tecnológico de Monterrey. Julio Rubio, Dean of Humanities and Education School, Tecnológico de Monterrey, Mexico City Region, and also Pablo Ayala Enriquez, Director of Social Impact, Vice Presidency of Inclusion, Social Impact and Sustainability del Tecnológico de Monterrey. As you can imagine, Mexico is now, I think it's 4 a.m. or something like that, so they were so kind to share with us a video, and we will have the chance to discuss also with different people. So first of all, please let me introduce myself. I am Fernando Vilariño, Associate Director of the Computer Vision Center, Associate Professor at the Computer Science Department at UAB. I usually have lectures on artificial intelligence, robotics, and open innovation, and I try to focus on models of open innovation using legal labs and citizen science. My research is related to artificial intelligence, and during the last years I've been participating in the design of different initiatives both at local and international level with the development of novel paradigms of digital social innovation. My main areas of expertise are centered around models of governance for living labs and for Alex instruments, innovation in libraries, museums, and cultural fields in general, and artificial intelligence. And I have the pleasure of honor, and I was invited to do so also by UAB, to coordinate the creation of a community of citizen scientists and practitioners, both at UAB, Universitat Autònoma de Barcelona, and also in the ECIU Consortium. But eventually, not everybody will be very aware about what ECIU is, and I think it is irrelevant. It's relevant to start with a small introduction about ECIU. ECIU is an Erasmus Plus program, and European University, as you probably know or are aware of, the strategy for the European Commission regarding 2030 is to have a number of pilots of consortia, international consortia of European universities, in order to find out what will be like this this university in Europe in 10 years' time. For that reason, they opened within the Erasmus Plus program a number of consortia, the possibility of creating consortia to investigate different dimensions. And ECIU, the European Consortium of Innovative Universities, is one of these consortia. The key elements of this European university are to have an open community, to have cutting-edge technologies, the development of an innovative co-creation model, and to focus on these transnational European education and research ecosystems. You are having here the number of members in the ECIU consortium, which are European universities, but, and this is very important because we have guests today with us, kindly from the Tecnológico de Monterrey, which is an associate member, not European member, but an external member that is contributing also to this innovative approach for transnational university consortium. And we will be very happy to hear today the contributions from Monterrey. Within this context, we are having the Smarter Project. The Smarter Project is an EU-funded project in order to develop this concept of EU European University, particularly with the creation of a research institute, a digital virtual research institute, in the focus of the Smart European Regions. The aim of this Smarter Project is to set up this institute and to develop a number of actions, for instance, an academy and a seed program, and also very important in our context, the development of citizen science in practice, with deepening in public engagement and to the development of a citizen science platform in order to use the Smarter and the ECIU community as the test bed to put in practice this new approach for the university of citizen science. Our expected outcomes are to create an assessment and validation of a number of pilots on citizen science, to create a number of guidelines and toolkits in order to implement this virtual institute with citizen science as a strong component on that, and also the communication and the dissemination. In our case, we're interested particularly here in the concept, in this context of the assessment and validations of the pilots, which will take place during this year. As a general approach, we are having different dimensions in this Smarter Project, in which capacity building is a strong component, also the research within the society, for and with the society, and the creation of a research agenda. And in these implementation activities, citizen science will be here in order to feed, let's say, the Smarter Academy and to try to implement a number of activities in a transnational way, together with the rest of the partners of the consortium. For that reason, it is important to have a number of, community building actions. And this is the first step for that, the number of webinars on citizen science. And this is the reason why we are here, and we have our guests to start creating this community of citizen scientists and practitioners at the ECIU community. And then during the first week of February, we'll have a co-creation process in order to set up a number of pilots. These pilots of citizen science, these will be transnational pilots within the ECIU community, will be carried out by the end of Q1. And eventually they will be aligned with EU project proposals so that we can have parallel funding for them to run. Then we will have the pilots running during Q2 2022 and expected to be finishing in Q3, the latest Q4 2023. So we will have 1 year in order to have joint projects of citizen science together in the Smarter Project. And this is our first step. Just to try to meet together and to know more about our research. And with this small introduction, I just finished with the context of this smarter approach, and we are really looking forward. I would like to introduce Professor Ralph Oderpohl, but I see that the bio that we introduced is from a different person. So, Ralph, I'm so sorry for that. And I would kindly ask you to just introduce yourself and to provide us a little bit of information about your background. My excuses. Sorry for this.
All right. Yeah. Well, I'll first. Pull up my slides. So where is it? You see it? Is it up for everybody?
Yes, we are seeing it, but we are not seeing it full screen.
Okay, I'll make it. Is it full screen now?
Yes, it is. Good.
All right. Yeah. Well, so then a short introduction to what I do, and let me just, whoops, that was not intended, preview. Short introduction to myself. I'm based at Hamburg University of Technology, TUHH, I'm representing the Faculty of Civil and Environmental Engineering. Myself, I'm specialized in wastewater engineering, and I've moved very much into the field of restoration engineering, improving soil quality, switching to regenerative agriculture in order to assure water renewal, food security, and also to assure the balance of climate, what is to most extent, to the largest extent, dependent on the water cycle, cloud formation, and so on. In this context, part of a citizen science project, what we do since many years now. And it seems to me that citizen science is extremely important, especially now. So first of all, many students or many people around the world wouldn't have the option to join a university. Tuition fees are very high, and also the number of places is not sufficient. And the second thing is that the curricula of universities are centered around getting a job in industry administration and so on. But now it is becoming clearer that we need a lot of people to work in a way of setting up their own small businesses, to be creating a local local economy that is stable. And for that, we need a lot of materials for citizens themselves to get the knowledge and to set up their own little enterprise. And so I have concentrated on this since a few years already, and we have developed one of the first interactive toolboxes for Hamburg, and the toolbox is developed in the context of the WHO, Hamburg Open Online University. And here we have one of the stupid things in my point of view. The only thing that is English in Hamburg Open Online University is the name, that this is in English. It's mainly something that is in German, but our content is in five languages. But first, let me introduce to you the platform of WHO. It is a cooperation of all universities in Hamburg. So this is ourselves. To the left-hand side, it's the arts university, music, and we have the university clinic is part of it, Hafen City University, that's architectural and civil engineering, city planning university. And then we have the University of Applied Sciences of Hamburg. And with that, this is the website of WHO. This is just one screenshot from a video that is starting once you pull up the WHO. The link is visible here. So it is hoou.de. DE is the extension for Germany. And as I said, it's mainly in German, but I'll get to our content that is multilingual. So topics in WHO are displayed here. And this is like natural sciences, sustainability, topics around Hamburg itself, film and media, medicine and health, and then education topics. And there would be 19 more, and that shows a little bit the complexity of the system. So there are 250 different projects in there, and that's something what makes it a bit difficult to navigate. So that's why we have this top structure, natural sciences, and then you narrow down where you want to be. So in the next slide, there is one example. I want to present two examples, and those are the two that are the longest standing and have created a lot of excellent content. And this one is Kinderforscher, so that means children scientists or children researchers. And this is especially important because we have so few people who want to go into engineering topics, and we are a university of technology, and so we are suffering a bit from not too little interest. So many would join, but the number of people who are really well prepared from school is not that high. And that's why we have this children researchers program that is also running since a few years. And that's, in my point of view, citizen science at its best. Unfortunately, it's in German only. And now I come to, and they have a lot. You see the three pictures representing only a small section of all what they have. And so this is about airplanes. Why do they fly? Why are helicopters flying, and so on. Now I come to the project that we have developed, and this is the WHO Hamburg Open Online University content called Revival. And this is how it is displayed. And now you see we have different languages, even Urdu, what is the language basically of Pakistan, but also understandable for people speaking Hindi, so most of people in India, and of course English. And then for the colleagues of Monterey, hi, we have many people from Monterey also at our university in our Erasmus exchange, and it works very well. I'm really glad about that. And so we also have it in Spanish. So this is the Revival website that is also standalone, so that we are not only lost in 250 other topics of the total WHO. So Revival, Rural Revival, and we have a lot of situations like that in many parts of the world, and also in Europe, especially Mediterranean Europe. We have a lot of eroding areas that are really not very productive anymore. The water cycle is collapsing, and that's a threat for drinking water supply, food security, and it's disbalancing the climate in a horrible way. The climate is just out of balance, with very high temperatures at daytime, and it cools down very much at nighttime, so more or less desert climate. And so the idea behind our technologies in or technical approaches in reviving the rural is to apply those techniques of rainwater harvesting, regenerative agriculture. And now look at the picture. So this is a picture from China of the Lhasa Plateau that has been degraded even 3,000 years ago. So also old cultures were destroying their land, and they also destroyed themselves very often. So those cultures went down after destroying the land. And if we destroy our globe, then we will go down totally as humankind. And that's happening on a large scale, but luckily a lot of things can be done. And one example is this. If you look at this picture, 10 years later, from the same place in the same season, this has changed to this. And this is where we want to motivate people from all of society, citizens, sciences, and so available for everybody around the world. That's why we are multilingual. And we want to show that change is possible. And this change was done with things that made people wealthy again. So most people had migrated away, and after building terraces, bringing regenerative agriculture in, lots of trees, and the water table was restoring after a while. And this part that was restored is as big as Belgium or the Netherlands. So that's not a small thing. And the whole of the Les Plateaux is as big as France. So it's still a lot to be done. And that's why we want to spread the word. And now the contents of our revival tool are lectures. We have produced also reading. So that is some scientific background with in-depth science behind, because we are a university, so we bring the scientific background as well. But we make the topics accessible for people in a simple way, with, as you see here on the picture, with simple drawings. And we chose not to be modern, but to be more globally understandable for people, also those that are not too much into academics. And if you click on these items here, you can pull up the contents of the toolbox, and you have interactive learning. So you can enter answers, you can select different things, you can explore things on pictures. And I'll just read some of the contents here. So world water resources, then traditional rainwater harvesting, decentralized wastewater treatment, urine utilization, because urine contains almost all nutrients that we get from the land as food, and that needs to be fertilizer again. Then agricultural practices, livestock, we need to shift to rotational grazing. And then also we have the soil resources degradation, teaching on rainwater harvesting, and terra-preta sanitation, sustainable irrigation, agroforestry, and many more. And so that's what I wanted to show you, and I hope you have a bit of an overview. So that's just two projects of very many that are implemented in WHO so far. But this is the only one that goes very, very far. And the children scientists are also very advanced with a lot of content. Okay, so that's from my side. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you also for the details that you have provided us with. I have probably a number of questions now. We'll have the time later for debate as well. But I there is something that resonated to me very much. We were speaking about the project with children scientists and children researchers. And I think that this is something commonly shared by all of us, particularly with the lack of absence of girls in studying engineering studies. I would like to know if this is something that this gender dimension in the engineering, something that you are working also, or this is something that that is happening also in your project of children scientists.
Well, that's one of the goals of this children scientists or children researchers project. is also to get all kids interested, and that would also make it available more for the girls. And it doesn't really work only through computer. So we have a couple of colleagues who go into schools and present such content, because if you produce content on a computer, it will not distribute so easily. So you really must be out there, meet the people, meet the teachers, hand them over the materials, show them, include this into your classes at some point, what is suitable for the age. And then, boys and girls, they have the choice. And if girls don't like it, they should not do it. It's like simply if you should choose what you really want to do. But those girls that really love to do it, they should have the opportunity and get into it early on and in a good way, where they are sort of led in a interesting way.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
There's my real CV now. Thank you.
Yes, I just reacted. So sorry for that. But now I think that you are having all the people that are interested in the details and contacting you, and you having your proper description. Sorry for the previous slide. But thank you very much for these two very interesting projects. I would like to say vielen Dank, Ralf.
Yeah.
And let's
thank
let's,
you very much.
Muchas gracias. Let us meet, and please be aware about the pilots of the ECIU, because I believe that these social components that you have been developed are shared by many of our scientists as well. Okay, now I have the pleasure to move forward, and I would like to introduce the presentation from the Tecnológico de Monterrey. But we have the pleasure to have with us Antonio Pita, who is from Tecnológico de Monterrey, and I would like to invite you, Antonio, probably before I introduce the slides and the presenters and the video that you have kindly shared with us, if you would like to share a number of words about Monterrey.
Yes, thank you very much, Fernando, and good morning to everybody. It's a pleasure to be with you. I am actually based in Switzerland. As you know, probably the Tec de Monterrey has 15 international offices, and I handle one office of the Tecnológico de Monterrey in Switzerland. So I'm the director of the international liaison office for the Tec de Monterrey here. And we also have in Europe some other offices, international liaison offices. We have one at Hull University in England. We have another one at DTU in Copenhagen. And another one that will be opened in this month in the Politécnica de Madrid in Spain. So basically, those are the four offices that we have here in Europe. The rest are distributed throughout the world: China, Australia, and the American continent throughout. Anyway, what I did want to do before we make the presentation of the Tec de Monterrey, because what we tried to do in presenting our experiences with citizen sciences is to make this recording, because as Fernando said, we have a time difference of 7 hours, and it would be a little bit difficult for everybody to be at this time. So we asked them to make a recording of the presentation. But before listening to the recording, I just wanted to say a couple of words. Citizen science in the Tec de Monterrey is framed on two very basic initiatives that the Tec de Monterrey has. One is the Tech 21, a new educational model. And basically, another one is the International Center for Social Innovation that we have in the southern state of Chiapas in Mexico. Chiapas is bordering with Guatemala, so it's the most southern state of Mexico. The Tech 21 educational model is a challenge-based degree program that the Tec de Monterrey started in August of 2019. And it covers all the degree programs in all our six national schools. So basically all the education right now that the tech is handling is based on challenge-based initiatives. So Tech 21 exposes students to real life problems and also provides at the same time the courses needed to complement the student's present day knowledge about the challenge it is going to face and is going to deal with. So basically this is the fundamental structure of the Tech 21 educational model. Basically, the courses that we have that help the students deal with the real life challenges that they're going to face are related to citizen science and are subjects that are combined with social service experiences. In Mexico, basically, the federal government, since many years ago, there's a law that actually requires all students who go to the university to do a social service experience in return for the privilege, let's say, of being educated in a university. So basically, everybody has to do, in order to get his degree, a certain amount of hours of social services before he actually graduates. So we try to use the social services experiences as one way to actually relate to citizen sciences in that regard. Another very important aspect of the citizen science approach is that we do, and with the Tech 21 educational model, is that we do the training of the teachers, the Teamsters, let's put it that way, or Teamsters, as ECIU now calls them. And the training is focused basically on special problems related to the Sustainable Development Goals, the Sustainable Development Goals number 2, number 10, number 13, and number 16. So we do have a preparation or a training for all the teachers focused on these special sustainable development goals. And then we do have the field work, and the field work with the communities in real life challenges. And this field work is basically mainly focused on the center, the International Center for Innovation and Social Sciences that is located in Chiapas. And here, the interesting thing is that even from the beginning, from the start of the formulation of the real life challenge that they're going to face is done and done in combination with the local communities. And here the local communities have one very special thing because they're indigenous communities and they don't even speak Spanish. So basically what you will see also is the indigenous communities communicating to the students in facing the real life challenges that they're going to actually work on being talked about in their real language. And so basically the communities themselves are the ones who actually present the real life challenge. And then the students and the teachers work together with the citizens, with the community, to solve that challenge, basically, and come with a result that actually then is a total citizen science engagement, because it engages the students, it engages the Teamsters, and it engages the communities themselves to come up with results. So with that, I just want to leave you now with the presentation, with the recording that the Tec de Monterrey sent us. But I wanted to give you this perspective so you can understand where we're coming from, and basically how it is related to these two initiatives that are fundamental to the tech right now, the Tech 21 educational model and the International Center for Social Innovation in Chiapas. So Fernando and Sofia, if we can ask you to please present the presenters also of the tech, and at the same time present the recording. Thank you very much. I'll be here for answering any other questions that you might have afterwards. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to have this context. And I'm coming to you from Monterrey. I'm going to share now the video, and please let me know if you can hear.
My name is Nancy Rivas from Monterrey Tech in Mexico. My colleague Julio Rubio and Pablo Ayala will present some of the activities We are working on Tech 21st model related to citizen science. Among many strategies to teach citizen science, we want to focus on three types: courses, training, and research. Talking about courses, we have some subjects that are combined with a social service experience, like an instance, Cultural Heritages of Mexico. Related to training, we offer teachers training focused on teaching about social problems in the classroom. For example, we already associated some sustainable development goals, such as zero hunger, reduce inequalities, climate action, and peace, justice, and strong institutions. And from all these citizen science experiences designed for teachers and students, some researches are conducted. The courses we talk in Tech 21st model combine real-life scenarios with interdisciplinary activities. In this example, the subject Cultural Heritages of Mexico, we worked with a community of artisans interested in sharing their heritage through their work. The students focused on the community's problem and used some active listening tools known as they were able to understand the situation and connect it with the LTG 10, reduce inequalities. In partnership with the textile artisans community, Ruta Kutlenhal of San Andres Larrainta, Chiapas, the Cultural Heritages of Mexico students focused on developing strategies that favor the broadcasting of cultural objects of this artisans community. The challenge gave us as a result co-created initiatives that enhance the cultural heritage value of these community members by reinforcing through these projects or initiatives their capacities for inclusion, self-sufficiency, and active participation in their social environment. All these strategies will attract tourists, researchers, other organizations to know the work carried out in this community, value it, and position the space of San Andres Larrainza as a site with cultural and historical interest. Now, I invite my colleague, Julio Rubio, to talk about their research.
I'm going to continue the presentation showing some of the research results we have. We can see some of the conferences and journals where we have presented the results. But what is, I think, very important to notice is that these results were obtained with the participation of students, professors, and community. And in that sense, this is very similar to your model of citizen science. To begin, we are going to see testimonial presentation of students, community, and professors.
Consumo de agua potable. Es la problemática del agua, por ejemplo, en ciudades como en la Ciudad de México, ya es un problema de escasez de agua y aquí la gente ni siquiera ha tenido la oportunidad de tener agua potable. O sea, como algunas ciudades ya están presentando el problema de escasez cuando aquí ni siquiera ha llegado un acceso de agua segura.
¿Cómo bebían agua antes de la Mesita Azul? ¿Cómo era la purificación del agua que bebían?
Shula de Mesita Azul. Ile aguti da vali de aguti.
E haban be yahbulan destek. 20 minutos. Generar ideas nuevas para que los socios formadores o los beneficiarios de los proyectos que propongan los alumnos mantengan efectivamente un impacto, una posibilidad de transformar el entorno y las prácticas que tienen para mejorarlas en vías de una calidad de vida.
nos fuimos a una reserva ecológica a ayudar a una comunidad. De ahí, más específicamente, se llamaba El Triunfo. Y entonces, ¿cómo ayudarlos a sacar adelante a la comunidad con todas estas limitaciones que tienen por ser una reserva? Pero nos platicaron mucho de ellos y, bueno, nosotros íbamos con intención de enseñarles, pero yo creo que fue algo muy chistoso porque aprendimos muchísimo más nosotros de ellos y eso es lo más bonito, ¿no? Esa es la experiencia que más me ha gustado, la reserva, el contacto con la naturaleza y estas enseñanzas que nos dejó toda la comunidad.
Los chicos venían con una idea, con muchas expectativas y este encuentro con las comunidades, con los otros formadores, los ha cambiado en un proceso que es relativamente corto, pero muy significativo.
Es una experiencia completamente distinta a lo que esperaba y muy, muy enriquecedora.
Estamos ayudando a la organización de tejedores. La verdad es que hemos avanzado mucho para solo tener estas semanas. Yo creo que sí le hemos ayudado sobre todo a darle una identidad a los tejedores.
Ok, para ellos es pues, toda la tradición que llevan de sus mamás, los diseños, hasta hace poco que probé el proyecto de Kiptik, pues eran súper tradicionales, o sea, siempre son los mismos, tienen como el valor simbólico de que se los enseñaron sus mamás.
Es la oportunidad de servir, es la oportunidad de concientizar a nuestros chicos, de abrirles los ojos también, de que es una realidad que no es su realidad cotidiana.
La realidad es cruda, es cruel, es diferente y nosotros tenemos que ayudar a que esa realidad mejore, cambie.
Porque hay mucha gente también con muchas carencias que ves en la calle a los vendedores pidiendo dinero, indígenas, y pues es difícil asimilar ese contraste y asimilar que esa es pues, la realidad en San Cristóbal y en muchísimas partes de México y del mundo.
Te das cuenta de que necesitas hacer algo al respecto, que puedes usar tus habilidades, ya sea como diseñador, como ingeniero, para poder hacer algo para solucionarlo.
Creo que lo que han demostrado los muchachos en primera es un deseo de contribuir, de acercarse a una realidad distinta, de tomar los retos que se les han presentado, trabajar en equipo, aprender de las mismas comunidades, aprender de las organizaciones con las que están trabajando. Y eso requiere deseo de asumir un reto y poner su talento a ver cómo resuelves ese problema, que ahí es lo que han demostrado todos los muchachos.
Esa posibilidad que tenemos de pagar una hipoteca social al tener la oportunidad de poder estudiar, en mi opinión, en la mejor universidad del país, y que eso, de una u otra manera, todo lo que yo pueda hacer por mi país, lo que pueda hacer por mi comunidad, pues siempre será bienvenido. Y creo que los chavos, como yo te decía hace rato, esto ya los marcó.
Que no nos importa ir hasta el fin del mundo con tal de ayudar, con tal de trascender, con tal de dejar huella, con tal de dejar el nombre del Tecnológico de Monterrey en alto, nuestro nombre también, como para decir el Tecnológico de Monterrey está haciendo algo bien con su nuevo modelo TEC21.
Los retos diseñados en el verano y fomentan la participación de alumnos de las diferentes carreras del Tecnológico de Monterrey. Como director del Tecnológico de Monterrey en Chiapas, los invito a ser parte de esta gran experiencia que sin duda dejará una profunda huella en su formación personal y profesional, que contribuyen al pago de nuestra hipoteca social y al desarrollo del sentido humano. Los esperamos en Chiapas.
Well, what kind of results we have obtained? We can see here some of the graphics we presented in our paper. And what we are trying to understand is mainly the development of competencies. And this as the result of an analysis of the students' report. And in the presentation in the formative program, and you can see some graphic here, and we are going to show some other graphics and some of the specific competencies that we have studied. Please, Mike, we are all trying to understand the different elements. You can see here, trying to show interactions between students with professors centering a challenge with a methodology, but always with the goal of developing a specific competence. Please, next. So we are going to see very briefly three competencies that we work in this project. The first one is innovative entrepreneurship and social innovation. And we can see students perceive that they develop this competency in high or very high level, mainly the development of social intelligence competency. We can see it here again with high and very high development according to the perception of students. And finally, get consistent commitment. And again, we have very high development. So, as you can see, that we are working in this project with a very strong emphasis on citizen commitment in collaboration with the community. We have some of the graphics. If you want to know more, we'll give you the reference to the different papers that we have presented. And to end this presentation, Dr. Pablo Ayala is going to give us some final remarks.
As we could see, the different learning experiences from the International Center for Cultural Innovation are clearly aligned with the educational principles and purposes of the projects promoted from the field of the citizen science. Testimonies of students, teachers, and those who lead the civil society organization with which we work in different communities have left us with a certainty that learning challenges addressed in our courses and social immersions are very effective ways to develop learning competences associated with civic and citizen empowerment. Tools that education have improved. But the learning challenges designed from a real problem allow our students to co-design innovative solutions to the problems faced by the communities, which, on the other hand, the learning challenges allow the students the contribution of their education. Next, please. Finally, on behalf of my colleagues and myself, I want to thank you for the space you gave us. For interest in having your students, teachers, and researchers visit us at the National Center for Cultural Innovation or any of the secondary campuses. Thank you. If you want to know more about our projects or courses, you have information of us.
Very good.
Thank you very much for our colleagues from Tecnológico de Monterrey, Nancy Rivas Moreno, graduated in applied linguistics with emphasis on translation, with master in education, that has an ample experience in instructional design, face-to-face and online teaching. Nancy is correct to the project coordinator and area development and social of social impact, supporting the deployment of the social service at Tech 21, that as we learned now, is the strategy for Tecnológico Monterrey. We also heard by Julio Rubio Barrios, Dean of the Humanities and Education School for the Tecnológico Monterrey in Mexico City. Julio, as a Dean of Humanities and Education, has an academic background that covers scientific and technological fields, as well as humanities and social sciences, which we have seen, and it is quite relevant in the challenge-based approach that technological and ECIU is working. He has a BA with an automation, electronic and communication engineering from the same technological Monterey, a master in physics from the University of Texas. He has also been working on humanities and social sciences and a master in philosophy and science in Universitat Autònoma Metropolitana and a PhD cum laude in the philosophy of science of the University of Valencia. Dr. Rubio has written articles for national and international publications, and he's a member of Mexico's national research system with articles in journals such as Studies in Social Sciences and Humanities, International Review of Social Sciences, European International Journal of Science and Humanities, Juripolis Principle, etc. And within the Technological Monterey, has the following positions: as academic director in the Mexico City region, as we have seen, and academic and research support director also in the Mexico City region, general director of the campuses of Mexico and Santa Fe, and he is also the Dean of Humanities in the School of Mexico City region. So with that, we have a bigger picture about the contributions also for Julio. And finally, our last presenter was Pablo Ayala Enriquez, Director for Social Impact and the Vice Presidency of Inclusion, Social Impact and Sustainability from the Technological Monterey. He has a doctorate in ethics and democracy from the University of Valencia in Spain, and he currently serves as Director of Social Impact and the Vice Presidency of Inclusion, Social Impact and Sustainability. He's a member of Directive Academic Councils at International Center of Social Innovation, Egonogazo Center, Latin American Network, and others. He is also an editorial writer for newspapers Milenio and Noroeste. And among the coordination, he has another book titles, for instance, Rethinking Citizenship, The Challenges of New Global Impact, Growing with Our Values, a Comprehensive and Dynamic Training Model for Elementary Education, and Values to Live Together, a proposal of formation in values from preschool education. He has been also a visiting professor at the Universidades of Ibagué, Colombia, San Peru, and others. And together with them, we also had the pleasure to have Antonio Pita with us, who already introduced himself, and speaking from Switzerland. So I think that we have had a very good panoramic overview of what Technological Monterey is doing. I am really, really fascinated about the Tech 21 approach, the approach for community development also, and this service learning approach, that it is intrinsic to all the students in the university in Mexico, which I think that it is having a potentially a social innovation element agent, let's say, from the university, that it is intrinsic for this service learning approach. And I, as a matter of fact, I will have also a number of questions to all the presenters, but since we have the pleasure of having also here with us Antonio, I would suggest, I was curious about this religion, let's say, right, of social changers and social innovators that you are having, and community developers that you are having in your in Technological Monterey. My question is, would be, through this innovation process and eventually from the knowledge generation, two questions: to what extent are you able to gather all the scientific results that you are getting so that we can have a sound narrative from all your students, from this plethora of students? And the second one would be, to what extent do you perceive that your students are being able to set up startups or social companies, or giving the leap, let's say, right, from the service that they are doing in the university through with their communities towards their own companies or enterprises? Antonio, I don't know if you have any clue about these two very difficult questions.
Well, no. The first one, actually, I would relay a little bit to the people at the Tech de Monterrey, but basically I do know that there, as you saw that from the presentation, that basically there is a lot of reporting of the results of all the citizen science experiences through various publications and so forth. So there is a gathering of all the research results. To what extent do we actually complement or handle the 100% of all the results that we have? I don't know, but I think we do a pretty good job at it. And probably in all the publications that some of them you saw there, and some of the ones that we actually make, I think you will find a good balance of all the results of these citizen science experiences. So I would refer you to that basically in that regard. And with regard to your second question, it's very interesting because basically the Tec de Monterrey has had a very long standing tradition of entrepreneurship in that sense. And basically one of the things that we are proud of is that basically we can tell you that after 20 years after leaving the university, we found out that 75% of our students or 65% of our students had their own company. And basically they had evolved from actually, you know, getting an educational degree for working for a company to actually setting up their own business. What percentage of those businesses are really socially oriented? I really can't tell you right now. But what is interesting is the fact that a very, very large percentage of all our graduates do end up setting their own company after a couple of years. I would say 35% of them actually have their own company after 5 years of leaving the university. And we go to 20 years and then you have 65 to 75% of them have their own company and are working on their own in that sense. And we do have incubators and technological parks and things like that. As you know, the Tec de Monterrey has 26 campuses throughout Mexico. And so in each one of the campuses, we have a technological park or something related to it, basically, and also the promotion of entrepreneurship. All the students at the Tec de Monterrey have to take some courses in entrepreneurship, basic courses. And if some ideas actually start coming up from them, we help them out and steer them to an incubation setup so that they can actually work on their ideas at that time. So basically, yes, we have had that for a very, very long time in that sense. I think since the early 70s, we started working in that regard with promoting entrepreneurship in every sense of the word.
I see Ralph's hands willing to contribute. So please, Ralph, if you want to say something at all.
Yes, thank you very much for this presentation. So it's impressive what you are doing. And it's exactly the thing that we need to go into entrepreneurship, that people really start to set up their own little enterprise in a way that is helping with the environment. And I would highly suggest to include the agricultural practices, gardening practices, because that's what's available for basically most families in Mexico, at least. Yeah. And so the rural development is a key to success. In the rural, people have the option, they have the space. Cities are very restricted. You can get a job or nothing. And if you're out in the rural, you can develop the rural regions. Sure. And with this, I want to express my interest in cooperating in this citizen science with Monterrey, the different campuses. We work with one of them, with the one in Monterrey, very, very long already. But we want to, we have something with the revival system that is really, it's 30 people hours, people years in there. 30 people years already put into that. So that can be used also. We have it in Spanish. And we would like to include the cultural things and the small enterprise activities from Mexico. And that's absolutely great. So thank you very much. I'm glad I found out about this. And for ECIU, this is probably a great way of cooperation. Thank you.
No, thank you, Ralph. I really appreciate it. And I was watching also your presentation I said, wow, this is something we have to interrelate with the Tech de Monterrey also. And I totally agree with you with the rural aspect and the rural communities. And I know you have been working with Monterrey basically, but I would like to link you also with the rest of the campuses and see what we're doing in that area. And by the way, the International Center for Social Innovation is open. We have facilities in Chiapas, and we invite all researchers if they want to come for a day or a week or a month or 6 months, we can definitely host them. And if they want to participate in these real life challenges posed by the 26 communities in around Chiapas, we're more than welcome. And I think it would be a mutually enhancing experience in every sense of the word.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thanks both for these good presentations and very, very inspiring also examples of social development and engagement. And I think that we have the chance with the pilots that the Smarter Project is going to develop into the following months to identify if we could have critical mass in order to address this rural dimension on citizens, the citizen science component. And so please, Ralph, be super proactive. And we are also looking forward to meet in probably a better timing and a schedule during the day with our colleagues from Monterrey. Maybe in the afternoon would be better, probably, yes. For all. I would like also to open the door. I don't know if any of the attendees in the webinar are also wanting to have a comment or any question that is willing to share with us. Okay, I don't see any questions. Okay, good. Look, so we still have a couple of minutes, and probably if you would like to share some comments or questions in the chat, we can address it later. But I had this thing annotated here that is related to the dimension of linking innovation together with citizen science. We have heard in the last webinars, for instance, the role of living labs as potential tools for the development of citizen science component. And we have heard also the
yeah.
Don't hear you anymore.
I don't hear you. You sort of froze, Fernando.
Yes. No, well, he's not in there. Yeah. I'll put my camera down to lower the bandwidth.
Yeah, likewise, I'll do the same thing.
Hello?
There you are, Fernando.
Yes,
okay.
You're back. Okay. Yeah.
You're back.
Okay. I just reacted and used my mobile phone to try to at least and finish in to help finish in these presentations. Yes, can you hear me well now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Very well.
My question was regarding the link between innovation and the citizen science. How the data that we are creating together with our communities, okay, can develop to new strategies. And this has to do also with, in my opinion, a rethinking of the university itself, right? So I'm very curious, for instance, Ralph, to what extent this is also changing the way in which your university is addressing the social impact in the territory, or how they are collecting with public engagement together with the regions or together with the municipalities. This, let's say, third mission that our universities used to have, which is technology transfer, is now different, is driving the social impact. I don't know if you share this vision or you can criticize it.
Yeah, absolutely. So this is something what we are realizing now. So we have also all the entrepreneurship, the startup doc at UHH. And to be honest, we sometimes had more staff in that unit than students who wanted to start something. So our university system is very much oriented towards big industries. And so the innovation that we produce in research is very often to make big processes a little bigger, a little bit better, so gaining a few percent. But we realize we must go into decentralization. We must go into technologies that are applicable in smaller scale. And the technology is allowing this now. The fab labs can do great things, but they are not enough. They are overestimated at the moment. There is some feedback. The development of technologies that would work for small enterprise, say up to people or something. For biotechnology, we have tried, but 10 people wouldn't be sufficient. So we need 50 people for that branch. So it's different from branch to branch, but extending to people who really are entrepreneurial, but they wouldn't like to work in big industries. And that's something what is missing. So most universities that I know of are to a large extent working for the big industry, but not for the people. And so that needs to change. We need to get to a level for, and that's why I love citizen science so much, because we reach out to people that are potential entrepreneurs and people setting up small companies. And that goes a long way. The local economy is something, especially now with the crazy things going on. So the supply lines are cratering, and this may even get a lot worse. So the local economy is the strong one. Local food supply, local water supply, balancing the local climate, so to have a good life in the region and not being in a desert climate that is unbearable. All these things can be done, and it's not in universities. This is normally not taught very much in universities, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Ralph. Antonio, we are having 1 minute. Yes, I would like to have some words also from you regarding this approach of public engagement, and how difficult has it been for Tech Monterrey to put the political actors into the equation?
Well, to put the political actors, if you talk about political, I think the Monterrey has had very good relations in general with the political establishment in that regard, as far as this social and citizen science innovation is concerned. And they're very appreciative of it. And I think we get a lot of support in that regard. But I was recalling right now of another example that I myself ran through at the Tech de Monterrey some years ago. And Ralph was saying about empowering also not just the students, but the community itself to be their own entrepreneurs and their own basically have their own company. And I remember that we went through a citizen science project in Guadalajara, in the high mountain region of Guadalajara. And the women there were making basically some beautiful artistic things that they would like to sell. And we worked with them, and they experienced a situation in which, in the end run, they actually started selling their artistic products of sewing and making these beautiful things to Apple, basically. And Apple having selling the covers for the tablets themselves. So in Mexico, you see the covers for the tablets now with these embroideries that are very special and very Mexican and very artistic. And these women actually ended up setting their own company, basically, in that sense. And that's really what we wanted. That's really what we wanted in every sense of the word. So that was one example.
Very nice story, huh? Very nice from local to global.
Yes.
Antonio, Ralph, and all the participants, we arrived to the end of this webinar. Thank you very much for all your contributions. Please stay tuned and let us keep on talking in the short future, and let us try to create together this big community of citizen scientists and practitioners around ECIU. So enjoy the day, and please, I'm looking forward to start this year with a lot of renewed strengths and with interesting projects in citizen science. Thank you very much. Goodbye.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Fernando.
It's a pleasure. Bye-bye. Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
We'll be in touch, Ralph.
Thank you.
Bye.